change can come on tiptoe. Love is where it starts. It resides, often hides, deep within our hearts. And just as pebbles make a mountain, raindrops make a sea. One day at a time, change begins with you and me. Ordinary miracles happen all around, just by giving and receiving comes belonging and believing. Every sun that rises never rose before. Each new day leads the way through a different door. And we can all be quiet heroes, living quiet days, walking through the world, changing it in quiet ways. Each and every one of us lights a spark, and the walls can tumble, and the mountains can move, the wind and the tides can turn. Ordinary miracles, one more every star. No lightning bolt or crash of thunder, only joy and quiet wonder. Endless possibilities right before our eyes. See the way a miracle multiplies.
Thank God for ordinary miracles like wonderful, talented musicians. Yes. Thank you, Diana and Kent and Todd. Wow. Well, good morning. As you may know, we are continuing our series entitled Escaping the Chaos Within. And just a quick recap for those of you who may not have been here the last couple weeks or heard the previous services or lessons. We are basing this on a book by Reverend Nancy Mercurio, who is the minister at Unity of Tampa, Florida. And she found herself at a point in her life where she was on the outside very successful. Two jobs, her life looked wonderful. But she began to realize that there was a chaos within, that she wasn't fulfilled, she wasn't happy, and she was burning out. And she said, so what do we do? How do we escape this chaos within? And she began to study and realized what so many of us have realized is that chaos, especially chaos within, is nothing more than energy we have within ourselves that is non-directed. So it just goes wherever it feels like going, in different directions, colliding in and amongst itself, and we feel chaos. We're not always consciously aware of it, but we know it's there because when we look around us at the world outside of us, what do we see? A lot of chaos. And we also know as Unity Truth students that what we see out there is a reflection of what is happening in here and in here. Now, no one of you or me is responsible for all the chaos out there, so take a breath. But the collective consciousness is. And if we are going to heal the collective consciousness, then we have to learn what to do with the energy that we have within ourselves and the non-directed energy that we call chaos. So today, we continue our series by asking ourselves a question. Now, if you read the e-letter, don't shout out the answer. If you didn't read the e-letter, the question is, how old are you? How old are you? Now, you may answer, well, I'm 30-something, 40-something, 60-something, 90-something, 110-something. But that's not how old you are. That is how long you have been on this planet, on this earth. Not how old you are. Years are a simple chronological measurement. And I know many people, and it may be one of you, who are far older than they look, act, feel. Do you feel like that? That, oh my gosh, am I really that old? I don't feel that old. I don't think that old. I don't look that old. If you come to the Glamour Gala, you might find clothing that makes you look even younger. Got to get a plug in there. It is said that age is an attitude, and that has been proven to be true. I love what Charles Fillmore wrote when he was about in his late 40s. He wrote, about 3 years ago, the belief in old age began to take a hold of me. I was nearing the half-century mark. Been there, done that. I began to get wrinkled and gray. My knees tottered and a great weakness overcame me. I did not discern the cause all at once, but I found in my dreams that I was associating with old people. And it gradually dawned on me that I was coming into this phase of a race belief. And so I spent hours and hours silently affirming my unity with the infinite energy of the one true God. I associated with the young, not just the young in years, but the young in consciousness. I danced with the boys. Now, this was written 100 years ago. I sang songs with them. And for a time took on the frivolity of a thoughtless kid. In this way, I switched the old age current of thought. And then I went deep within my body. And I talked to my inner life centers. I told them with firmness and decision that I would never submit to old age, that I was determined never to give in. And gradually, I felt a new life energy coming up from the center. It was a faint little stream at first, but as months went by, it got to the surface. And now it is growing stronger by leaps and bounds. My cheeks have filled out, the wrinkles and crow's feet are gone, and I actually feel like the boy that I am. Myrtle Fillmore received a letter one time from somebody who was concerned about aging. And he says, I just feel so weak and tired and overburdened. And she replied this way, let go of the mental attitude that causes a sense of burden, that belief in age that weighs one down with years. You live in God, not in years. You live in deeds, not in figures upon a dial. Instead of thinking, I'm getting up in years, get into the youthful spirit of joy in living and loving. You are a good man. We can feel the goodness and the sincerity and the loyalty of your soul as we read your letter and pray for you. You will notice that we did not say you are a good old man, for you are not old. You may have given way to some of the race beliefs in age and failed to take care of yourself and to make full free use of the abundant life and substance of God, but you are not really old. Now we'll explain. You are a threefold being, and this goes for all of us too. You are a threefold being. No doubt you have learned the facts from your Bible that the Spirit of God dwells in man and gives him breath, and that man has a soul and a physical body. But have you really studied these facts to understand them? Oh, we read the Bible, don't we? Well, some of us. It's a dry read. But we grew up with this. But do we ever really stop and think about what's it really saying behind the literal interpretation, behind how different people view it and try to tell us what it means? What is it really saying to me and to you as individuals? That's what Myrtle was getting towards. So to go continue to quote Myrtle, we have studied these facts to understand them so as to know how to use this threefold nature in the way that God intends. We have learned and are proving that the very presence and life and intelligence of God are ever abiding in our being. The Spirit of God is what gives us intelligence and life. For you, that life which we call the soul. And the soul has built the body and ever continues to renew and rebuild it day by day. Spirit has no age. It is eternal, as God is eternal and unchanging. The soul is not old in the sense of its being full of years and decrepitude. The soul is the ever unfolding of God's ideas, and these are unchangeable. The development of the soul qualities causes the individual to be more mature in his judgment and expression. And as the soul is ever in keeping in touch with that which is true of God and the Son of God, which is the Christ within, not just one man who lived a long time ago, is true of God and the Son of God, it is ever refreshed and eager for life's experiences. So I ask you again, how old are you? As a physical being, the truth is, you are no older than 7. You can never be older than 7 years old in the physical. Science has shown us that every cell in our body is replaced every 7 years. Now, this doesn't mean the body doesn't age. Of course it does. Even Charles Fillmore had to finally accept that with great reluctance, but he did. But that does not mean that we have to age. Now, I do believe that Jesus manifested a new body after the crucifixion. And I do believe that at some point in our evolution, that won't be a big deal. One of the ways we know that is we should understand that he was not the only person to ever do this. You read sacred scriptures from all over the world, or even just stories from around the world. And it happens over and over again. Jesus himself helped people resurrect and take on new bodies and heal from death, such as the son of the woman from Nain, Jairus' daughter, Eutychus, and of course, Lazarus. Can't forget Lazarus. And Jesus himself did it. But practically every culture on earth has stories about people who have done this. Either had a teacher in a way show or helped them resurrect, or did it themselves, or live far beyond what was considered a normal lifespan. If any one of those stories is true, what happened? What happened is that there have been people, enlightened people, men and women, who have understood how to use the inner energy. And if, as quantum science says, we are all energy, then it is not beyond the realm of possibility that people like Jesus and others learned how to use that energy and direct that energy to heal and to recreate themselves. I do believe that's how Charles and Myrtle Fillmore healed themselves and lived so much longer than everybody told them they would. All the experts. Ever been given advice by an expert? You know the old saying, it was an expert that designed the Titanic. Beware of them. So how do we do this? How do we do it? Now, I am not personally at the point yet of totally understanding how to do what Jesus and others like him did. But I do know that I am on the path to understanding. And you are here, so you are on the path to understanding. And whether I get there or not in this lifetime is not as important as believing in what we call life everlasting, in the human form or some other form. When we can do that, when we can get into that understanding that we are eternal beings, it's not just some pretty thing we say, it's the truth. We begin to become more adept at living fully. And that's the key, to live fully in this now moment, in this place. And to do that, we have to understand the energy that we have available is free. It's within us. It's all around us. And we have to understand that the chaos we feel is the experience of having that non-directed energy flowing in us. And that as we learn to direct that energy through alignment with ideas from God mind or divine mind, we become more energetic, livelier, and healthier. Jesus talked about this. This is what he taught. He said that you must become as little children. Now, he didn't mean to become childish. He meant to become childlike. Deepak Chopra says that a childlike behavior is more about being free-spirited. Free-spirited. What does that mean? That means that we allow God freedom to blossom within us. We allow ourselves the freedom to become more and more every day who we came here to be. We become more open to the gifts of the universe. And perhaps the one single most important thing to know is that we must be in the flow of energy. We must be in that flow. It's all about it. In Matthew 7:12, Jesus said, "So whatever you wish that people would do to you, do to them, for this is the law and the prophets." Now, that's more than just treat each other nicely. If we could do that, that would be wonderful. It would solve most of the problems we have here on earth. But it means even more than that, to treat other people as they are a part of the divine flow of energy that you are a part of, to see other people as God sees them, to see ourselves as God sees us. And when Jesus said that is the law of the prophet and the prophets, what he was saying in the terminology of his day is, this is physics. This is quantum mechanics. It's all about being in the flow of oneness. Oneness. It's unity's golden rule. We know that to prosper in any way in this experience, we have to be in a place of giving and receiving. Nothing is more or less important than that. And giving and receiving are neither one of those is more important than the other. You know, I just the other day was talking to somebody and they said, "Well, I had to pull myself up by my bootstraps. Nobody helped me. Why should we help others?" My friends, there is not one person on this earth that has totally made themselves successful by themselves. Now, yes, some people have had to work harder. Some people haven't had the same advantages. But the fact is, whether we are aware of it or not, literally thousands of people are responsible for where we are in life, where anybody is in their life. Parents, teachers, those who built a structure of a society that allows people to be free to explore their spirituality. Those who dreamed and made possible things like libraries and schools. When you really think about it, the list is endless. Total strangers may say one word that lifts us up. We are all part of a greater whole. We are all part of one energy. And regardless of what we think or where we are today, because those before us and with us have given and received of their time, talent, and treasure, we are where we are today. So what we begin to understand is there has to be a give and take of energy. There has to be a flow, a circuit of energy for life to be abundant. Think about plants. They take nutrients from the soil, sunlight from the sun, and they transform it, and they give forth oxygen and food. They give and they take. Same with animals. Think about economic systems. If money is not in circulation, we move into recession. And when too much moves into circulation, we move into inflation. It's all about give and take and balance. Earth herself has cycles. Cycles of evaporation, condensation, all that stuff you learned in fifth grade science. Giving and taking. All of creation. Which kind of makes sense. It kind of makes sense that humans must be in that reciprocal energy flow as well if we are to thrive. The great prosperity teachers have all taught the same thing. If you are lacking in any area of your life, look to see what you are withholding from life. And we do that. Most times unconsciously. Don't beat yourself up. It's part of the human experience. But we have tools. We can go within and we can look and say, okay, I'm lacking in the relationship area, or I'm lacking in the financial area, or I'm lacking in the wisdom area. And we say, what can I give? What am I holding on to that's blocking that flow of energy? Think about children and your pets. The beautiful thing about pets is they love unconditionally. Children love unconditionally. But what is truly fascinating is that both children and pets are willing to receive all of the love they can get. And so to begin to harness that chaotic energy within, we have to learn how to give and receive. Because what we are doing is establishing order, establishing a flow. Think about an electrical circuit. As long as it's flowing, the light bulb's light. If we stop that flow, it gets dark. We want more light, right? Right? Okay, I thought maybe I was in the wrong place. How do we do it? Well, we have to learn to give and receive without fearing, and this is the key, without fearing that we will lose what we give. That's one of the big blockages in the world today, is there's so many of us that are afraid that if we give of our love, if we give of our time, if we give of our treasure, we're going to lose it. But what happens, what we know happens, is that it increases the flow. Jesus himself taught about this. In Matthew 25, for to everyone who has, and I'm going to put some qualifications or explanations in here, to everyone who has and values its blessings and gifts from God, more will be given. And he will be richly supplied so that he will have an abundance. But from the one who does not have, because he has ignored or disregarded the blessings from God, even what he does have will be taken away. Now, Jesus was not talking about money here, although everything works in every area of life. He was talking about if we hold on to our truth, if we hold on to our love, if we hold on to our knowledge, even that will be taken away because anything that is not in circulation, anything that is not in flow, decays. And we lose it. When we understand that everything comes from divine mind or God, and we give back, we are creating a circuit. So therefore, a great place to begin is to look at our lives. And no matter how enlightened you are, if you are on this planet, there is some part of our lives that is out of balance. So we take the step, we just go within, we look to say, where is my life out of balance? If it is health, go within for guidance. And then go to wherever you are directed to people who have the skills to help you recover. If it isn't in relationships, explore how you relate to others. What are your thoughts about other people? And this is a tough one. We're a unity people. We love everybody. Except maybe those people who don't love everybody else. Maybe those people who are presenting to the world as what we would say bigoted or prejudice. Do we love them? Boy, what do we think about them? What are my thoughts about those people? You know who I'm talking about. It's different for all of us. But who are those people? What am I thinking about them? Am I sending them thoughts of disgust or disrespect, or thoughts of love and compassion? Because that which we give energy to does what? Increases. It does come back to us, but it increases. What we give out comes back, multiplied. So if we want more love in the world, if we want more acceptance in the world, if we want more empathy and compassion in the world, we have to do that ourselves. With our finances, am I out of balance in my finances? Am I lacking? Go within. Where can I give forth of my treasure? We are all energetic beings. We are all striving to be more and more and more in the flow of life. And if we're not totally where we want to be, it's because something in us is blocking that awareness. And that's okay. That's why we're here. You know, some people say, well, that means I have to work. That means I have to look for the darkness within myself. If you're here, that's why you're here. We're moving to the light. We're becoming brighter. But I don't know about you. I'm not there yet. I'm headed there, as I know each and every one of you are. My vision, my dream, is that we can grow to live a life that is abundant. Like Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and have it. Oh, you guys are so good. Abundantly in all areas. Think about what we do here at Unity. How we are working more and more to reach out to our community, to help our community. Today at 1 o'clock, we're going to have an Albuquerque Interfaith where there's going to be people like Chuck and Scott, or Chuck and Bob Edgar, talking about things we can do, not just to treat poverty and homelessness, but to end it. You know, most of what we do as human beings, we treat the symptoms. We do it, all of us. But our mission is to end it. Think about what we could do, what our vision is here. Our vision, my vision anyway, is to grow to the point where we are planting other Unity places around the state, because the world needs what we're teaching. To have a school for children right here where they not only get academic learning, but where they get the Unity principles to live life abundantly and to be healers and teachers and way showers themselves and to fully express who they came here to be. All of these dreams require that we be more fully aware of and using the flow of energy, that we have a deep understanding of what it takes to manifest from energy to expression. I feel that energy growing here. Do you? I see it. The flow is increasing as we get into the consciousness of the emotion of it. That's why I love the energy in this room, in this building, in this community, in this family. I come here on Sunday and I am energized, because I see what's happening. The flow is ever increasing as we get into the emotion of it. Emotion's important. The very word means to move out, to move the energy out into expression. So what is your emotion about the world? Do you feel safe? Are you optimistic about the future? Or do you buy into the fear messages that the news and media all around us promote? Oh, it's easy to do, let me tell you. It really is. But if that area is out of balance, change your habits. Tune into more illumined messages. And if you need ideas on where to find those messages, see me. I'll help you find them. So how? How do we do this? Well, one of the first things we start with is, as always, going within. Meditation. That's where we make that connection to divine mind. Emily Cady said, we must learn how to be still and let spirit, the I am, work in us. that we may indeed be made anew and whole and have the mind of the Christ in all things. Allow us to know that there is a path that always leads us to higher expression. That's what meditation does. It puts us back on that path when we get off. Everything we have ever experienced as individuals and as people has led us to a higher understanding. It may not look at it, especially not if you listen to the voices out there. Anybody hear the voices? On media, on the news, telling you how bad things are. But if you look at the broad arc of the human experience, every experience has led us to a higher place. I love what Richard and Mary Alice Jafola shared in a book called The Quest. If we view our lives from a broader perspective, we see that every episode along the way, no matter how difficult at the time, has proven to be a stepping stone to greater good. It was the part of the divine plan of our lives, and we, in viewing the overall pattern, can recognize the hand of God in every step of the way. Out of every twist and turn, we have been divinely led along the pathway to higher understanding and awareness, whether we knew it or not. By not attempting to predict outcomes and trusting in the path and not fretting about the means of our getting there, we smooth the way for God's divine plan to reveal itself easily and quickly. What are they saying? Don't try to resist the chaos. Use it. Use it. That's the one part where I kind of part ways with the author of the book. I don't want to escape the chaos. I want to transmute the chaos. Because the chaos is that energy that's just waiting for direction. It means that I have more energy than I knew I had. When I go, oh, I got chaos within. Oh, thank you, God. I'm alive, alert, awake, enthusiastic, and joyous about life. And all this energy is mine to use and direct through the power that God has given me. And the same is true for everybody. And as we begin to do that within ourselves, we begin to see it expressing in the world around us. And the more of us that do it, the less chaotic the world gets. So how old are you? How old? Seven. Never older than seven. But how old are we in consciousness? There is no age in consciousness. I'm 65 years old, but I don't feel it. And I know that life is eternal. And no matter how much longer I occupy this vessel, my spirit, will continue to grow. So do not try to resist chaos. Recognize it for what it is, that it is available to be put into circulation. We can transmute chaotic energy and turn it into useful energy. And when we do this, we become, as Charles said, filled with zeal. That's one of our 12 powers, zeal. And power is all about energy. This is the childlike enthusiasm that Charles Fillmore had at 96 years old when he wrote, "I fairly zizzle with zeal and enthusiasm and spring forth to do that which is mine to do." 96 years old. You and I can do the same, for we are never truly older than seven. Namaste.
I was down for so long. Everything I did was wrong, and I found fault in everyone but me. I was hurt and alone, could not find my way home. Broke down and hungry and too tired to moan. saying ain't no need to be ashamed. And I found out that the door was always open. I was trapped in my mind, a prisoner of my own design, lost in a world of confusion. I was there by myself, couldn't find help from nobody else. Thought I'd call the hotline, but there was nobody there. Then I heard somebody calling my name, saying ain't no need to be ashamed. And I found out that the door was always open.
Thank you, Diana. We have kids back.